Please turn your Bibles over to Daniel, the book of Daniel, chapter 6. We're going to be reading verses 10 to 28. I know it's a lot of reading, but it's a good read. Also, if you have a cell phone, please make sure they're turned off or in silent mode. Daniel chapter 6, verse 10 to 28. When Daniel learned that the document had been signed, he went into his house. The windows in its upstairs room opened toward Jerusalem. And three times a day he got down on his knees, prayed, and gave thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Then these men went as a group and found Daniel petitioning and imploring his God. So they approached the king and asked about his edict. Didn't you sign an edict that for 30 days any person who petitions any god or man except you, the king, will be thrown into the lion's den? The king answered, "As a law of the Medes and Persians, the order stands and is irrevocable." And they replied to the king, "Daniel, one of the Judean exiles, has ignored you, the king, and the edict you signed, for he prays three times a day." As soon as the king heard this, he was very displeased. He set his mind on rescuing Daniel and made every effort until sundown to deliver him. Then these men went together to the king and said to him, "You know, your majesty, that it is the law of the Medes and Persians that no edict or ordinance the king establishes can be changed." So the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel, "May your God, whom you continually serve, rescue you." A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den. The king sealed it with his own signet ring and the signet rings of his nobles, so that nothing in regard to Daniel could be changed. Then the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting. No diversions were brought to him, and he could not sleep. At the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. When he reached the den, he cried out in anguish to Daniel. "Daniel, servant of the living God," the king said, "has your God, whom you continually serve, has been able to rescue you from the lions?" Then Daniel spoke with the king. "May the king live forever. My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths, and they haven't harmed me. For I was found innocent before him and also before you, your majesty. I have not done harm." The king was overjoyed and gave orders to take Daniel out of the den. When Daniel was brought up from the den, he was found to be unharmed, for he trusted in his God. Then the king gave the command, and those men who made maliciously accused Daniel were brought and thrown into the lion's den. They, their children, and their wives. They had not reached the bottom of the den before the lions overpowered them and crushed all their bones. Then King Darius wrote to those every people, nation, and language who lived on the whole earth, "May your prosperity abound. I issue a decree that in all my royal dominion, people must tremble in fear before the God of Daniel. For he is the living God, and he endures forever. His kingdom will never be destroyed, and his dominion has no end. He rescues and delivers. He performs signs and wonders in the heavens and on the earth, for he has rescued Daniel from the power of the lions." So Daniel prospered during the reign of Darius and the reign of Cyrus the Persian. This is the word of God. Please join me in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you once again that you have given us another opportunity to be together physically and virtually, Lord God, to lift up our prayers to you, to sing songs to you, and now to study your word. Please open the eyes of our hearts that we will see your truth for us. Please open our minds that we will understand what it is you are telling us. Guide us, Father, by your Holy Spirit. Give us wisdom. Enlighten us, Father. Lord, I lift up to you my preparations, and let you and you alone speak to your people tonight. In your Son's mighty name we pray. Amen. 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 We are still in our series, Knowing God in Trying Times. And last week we discussed the importance of prayer and the command to not worry. So we're picking up from that. If there was any man Now we can see there's a lot of them in the Bible, but there's this one man, Daniel, who did not worry but prayed. We started in verse 10, but for those of us who know it and those of you who don't know it, there were these jealous people because Daniel was positioned to be one of the governors. And they did not like Daniel because Daniel was a straight arrow. There's no corruption in him. You have to understand, well, we all know it, right? When probably, more than likely, when you're in politics, there's corruption. Whether you like it or not, I'm thinking. Because imagine there's 20 of you guys and 19 of them are corrupt and you're the only straight arrow. Before you know it, your dirty socks will be muddy if you go out in a muddy area, correct? But not with Daniel. Daniel held his ground. You know, remember, there's been many years from Daniel 1, chapter 1, to Daniel chapter 6. At this time, Daniel was probably already, they say, between 70s, close to 80. But he was still going strong for the Lord. It's like Pastor Charles. It's so timely that you're here this evening. It's so timely that you are here this evening. I was actually thinking about you when they said 80. And I'm like, oh, okay. It's like Pastor Charles. We all have to know that the verse that says to finish the race, we have to imagine when we get old. When we're old and we're frail and we're weak, our bodies are not the same. I was actually just complaining about my leg. I got kneed by my son 3 Tuesdays ago. Yes, he's right there. And before I would recover in a day or two, and now I'm still waiting for it to fully recover from that injury. So, you know, as we get older, our bodies fail. It takes longer for us to heal. But our spiritual being must get stronger as we get older in the faith. Amen? Now, I'm not saying the older people are wiser. What I'm saying is the ones that are, not all the time, not all the time, right? It's not because they've been a Christian for 20 years. It means they're mature. They could also mean they're a bonsai Christian. They're just there, sitting, occupying space. But the whole point is, Daniel, with all these years, with his relationship with his Lord, there was a law that was passed that if anybody prays to God, to another God other than King Darius, he will be thrown into the lion's den. So his life was on the line. His life was on the line. But despite that, despite the danger to his life, he still did the same thing. If you would read that again in verse 10, he prayed just like he did before. 3 times a day, with his windows wide open, pointing to Jerusalem. Down on his knees, praying. You know, in these trying times, in these uncertain times that we are in, there's no way that you can stand against anything, any other these challenges that we're facing. Now there's a fire, there's smoke outside. Now we really have to wear a mask. It's not a political move. It's for our safety, right? Now, but I got lost there. But we need to understand, knowing God means praying to God. You can't know God and not talk to Him. I guess some of you are, right? Some of us, we only pray at church. Some of us, we only pray when we need things. There's a story about the girl named Susan. She's 9 and she hung up the phone talking to her friend Barbara. And then Susan started complaining to her mom. She goes, "You know, Mom, my friend Barbara, she's a timey friend." The mom goes, "What's a timey friend?" "She only calls me when she's in time of need. But when she's having fun, she forgets about me. She doesn't call me." So the mom goes, "Oh, that's too bad, sweetheart." She puts her to bed. Mom puts her to bed. She sleeps. And the mom goes, are you going to say your prayer? Are you going to read your Bible before you go to bed?" And Susan's yawning like, "Oh, tired, Mom. It's been a long day." She goes to bed. Wakes up in the morning. She woke up late. She ran downstairs. She slipped, twisted her ankle. And she goes, "Oh, Lord, my ankle, please help me."
I have to run a mile today. She said a quick prayer. Mom nurtures the babe, the daughter. And then in the afternoon, she goes, "So, sweetheart, how did you feel? How do you feel whenever Barbara just timely makes you her friend? I feel used. I feel irritated. I feel like we're really not friends because she only calls me when she needs something." And she goes, "How do you think God feels when you pray to him only when you are in time of need?" Well, she goes, "Well, I prayed this morning." "Yeah, when you twisted your ankle." Some of us, we need to improve on that part. So that's why we're going to have this Sunday. Last Sunday was about prayer. Tonight is going to be about prayer. And next Sunday is going to be about prayer again. But tonight we have three points. We have the W's this evening. Last week we have the C's. I don't know why I do it, but I do it. World versus God and his people, I want to say, but it's too short. World versus worry versus prayer. And then the watching world. Now, the first part, we're going to study 11 and 13. We're going to discuss that. But before we get there, there's this story about a boat sinking. There was a boat sinking. So the captain made an announcement. "Who knows how to pray? Everybody meet me by the deck." So they were at the deck, and the captain makes the announcement again. Who here knows how to pray? Joe raises his hand. "I know how to pray." And the captain calls him. "All right, come here. Good thing you know how to pray. So everybody, take a life jacket. You, Joe, you pray, because we're short one." And then there's Billy. Billy had been misbehaving and was sent to his room. After a while, he emerged and informed his mother that he had thought it over, then said a prayer. "Fine," said the pleased mother. "If you ask God to help you not misbehave, he will help you." "Oh, I didn't ask him to help me not misbehave," said Johnny. "I asked him to help you put up with me." I thought it was good. Anyway, here. These men were petitioning. They knew Daniel was going to pray. They put Daniel's life on the line, but Daniel still prayed, right? This pandemic has caused a great deal of uncertainty to the whole world. Certain guidelines have been put up for us and have been imposed on us to prevent, supposedly, the spread of this virus, which is highly contagious. We as Christians are told by God through Paul in the book of Romans, chapter 13, verse 1. It's coming. We have a lag for some odd reason. So here, "Let everyone be subject to the governing bodies, authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God." Why am I bringing this up? Because the law that was passed told everybody to not pray to any other god except to King Darius for 30 days. But Daniel disobeyed the law. Correct? So where do we bring that with this? This is where we bring this, folks. And it brings us to an example before I get to the verse. You guys all know about Pastor John MacArthur, correct? Pastor John MacArthur, he's a prominent pastor in Los Angeles, filed a lawsuit Wednesday against California Governor Gavin Newsom because of his second coronavirus lockdown order, including banning singing in houses of worship. John MacArthur told Fox News earlier this month that he had begun holding indoor services in the form of a peaceful protest at Grace Community Church in L.A. This is him. I quote, "We feel like we are the most essential reality in the world," MacArthur told the host, Shannon Bream. "Look, Jesus is Lord. He is the head of our church. Governor Newsom is not the head of the church. Mayor Eric Garcetti is not the head of the church." The lawsuit claims that the state is acting unconstitutionally and inconsistently. When many went to streets to engage in political protest against racism and police brutality, these protesters refused to comply with the pandemic restrictions. Instead of enforcing the public health orders, public officials were all too eager to grant a de facto exception for these favored protesters. The suit reads in part. We are simply continuing to do today what we have done for the past 63 years. Serving people in LA with their spiritual needs, MacArthur said in that statement. We will remain open and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ to all who decide they want to come worship with us. And then he said this, we don't spread anything other than the love of the Lord, other than the gospel. So when do we comply with the government's orders if it doesn't violate God's commands to us? Because we, Christians, belong to God. Amen? Amen. Amen. Pastor O'Malley answers the phone. Hello, is this Pastor O'Malley? It is. This is the IRS. Can you help us? I can. Do you know a Ted Julian? I do. Is he a member of your congregation? Yes, he is. Did he donate $10,000 to your church? Pastor O'Malley's answer, oh, yes, he will. Let's talk about taxes, guys, for those of you who didn't catch up with it. I bring that up because remember the incident when the Pharisees tried to test Jesus about complying with the orders of the government of Caesar when they asked him, is it right that we pay taxes to Caesar? Then Jesus said, give me a denarius. Whose inscription is in the denarius? And then they said, Caesar. And then Jesus said, give to Caesar what is Caesar's and to the Lord the Lord's. Folks, the question that should be followed with that is, whose inscription is on you? Now, if you tell me that God's image is on you, that the Holy Spirit is on you, then your life should be to the Lord. Amen? Amen. Inscription. Imagine that. We don't use those words now. But it suggests theme. If God's inscription is on you, his purposes, your purpose of your life is about God. Remember when young Jesus was lost in the temple and the step parents went to get him? And then he said, don't you know that I should be about my father's business? Folks, I get it. I still work too. I still work because I have kids that are still young and trying to think about college and everything. I'm still young. I still have the strength. I have to work. I know we have to work. I know we have bills to pay. I know we have certain responsibilities to do. But don't get that to become about your life. Don't let that become about your life. Because our life should be for the Lord. Now tonight's theme is about prayer. Daniel knew, if you look at the story of Daniel again, he functioned as the government needed him. He functioned with integrity as a God-fearing man, and everybody knew it. His testimony was great to a point that his enemies knew that the only way they can get Daniel in trouble was to be against the command of his God. Now, folks, we're being told, right? We're still being told 50 and below. There are some places are said, don't sing. So, I mean, we're complying with the 50 and below for now. But maybe I'm holding, maybe not in the future. Because we are essential. Amen? Us praising and gathering together is essential. Yes, for those who are concerned with their health, we encourage them to stay home and join us online. But those who want the company of their fellow believers. I mean, just the sight of the Reyeses last week in person, just the sight of the Lanes tonight, the sight of the Brockways coming back. Everybody, okay, I know I mentioned it. It encourages me personally. I know we take certain precautions, and that's fine, but it should be okay. We should follow the Lord, and our lives must be for Him. Amen? So again, ask the question to yourself, whose image in this inscription is on you? John 15, 18 to 25. If the world hates you, this is Jesus speaking, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. Remember what I told you? A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. If they obeyed my teaching, they will obey yours also. They will treat you this way because of my name, for they do not know the one who sent me. If I had not come and spoken to them, they would not be guilty of sin. But now they have no excuse for their sin. Whoever hates me hates my Father as well. If I had not done among the works no one else did, they would not be guilty of sin. As it is, they have seen, and yet they have hated both me and my Father. But this is to fulfill what is written in their law. They hated me without reason. Like Daniel, Jesus was a subject of jealousy. I wanted to touch this place. Daniel was a subject of jealousy from the satraps. They could not stand Daniel, and they could not stand the fact that a Jew, an exiled Jew, will be governing, will be like the prime minister and be watching over them. And they know they couldn't corrupt him. Just like Daniel, Jesus was subjected to an unfair trial and was given the harshest punishment of all, crucifixion. All for what? All to pay for your sins and mine. Now imagine Jesus on the cross. I know we've all seen the movie. If not, let me know. I'll send you my DVD if you still have a DVD player. But imagine Jesus on the cross. How his body was marred and broken for you. Now let me ask you. Would it be okay if that Jesus asked you to worship him on Sunday? Would it be okay that you obey certain laws, certain commands, particularly love God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, all your strength? Would that be okay? Because he gave his life for you. Shouldn't that be okay? If you were asked to live in the streets of India, to be a missionary in India, would that be okay if he calls you? Some of us are thinking, no, I want him to call me in the Philippines. That's where I want to be. Jealousy, folks, jealousy is one great sin that we can all fall into. Now, jealousy is to the closest to us. It happens to the closest to us. I'm never jealous of anybody that is far removed from me. For example, the jump shot of Damian Lillard, his three-pointer from the half court, I'm never jealous of it. I'm never jealous of it. But if I see Mikey start making his three-pointers in the half court, I will be jealous because Mikey is near me. He's near me. We are never jealous of people that we don't know. We are always jealous of the people that we are close to. There is this fictional character, a fictional story, where the demons were trying to tempt and make this holy man sin, but they could not make him fall. So the chief devil chief demon came up and he goes, "You guys are having a hard time with this guy? Let me give it a shot." Demon walks to this person, whispers something, and his face starts getting angry. And then the demons were like, "What did you tell this guy?" "Oh, I just told him that his brother is now a pastor in North Carolina." See, jealousy breeds contempt, right? It just makes us not loving. It makes us become fault finders of that person because we don't like that. In verse 4 of chapter 6, let me just read it to you. It's not here. "The administrators and satraps, therefore, kept trying to find a charge against Daniel regarding the kingdom, but they could find no charge or corruption, for he was trustworthy, and no negligence or corruption was found in him. Then these men said, 'We will never find any charge against this Daniel unless we find something against him concerning the law of his God.'" Galatians 6:10 reads, "Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers." Folks, the world will hate us. If they find out you're a Christian, automatically they think you're close-minded, you're a sheep, you're stupid, you're not smart, you're old-fashioned, you're boring, right? That's the world. And that should be okay because Jesus said, you know, the world will hate us. So we can take that. What hurts me personally is when fellow Christians do that to one another. When we do it to one another. When I hear Christians coming to this church say things about our fellowship, that hurts. That stings a lot. And the unfair thing is, you can't say anything in return. We can't even try to argue. Because then, especially if it's against me, then it becomes me becoming, it's unbecoming of a pastor if I try to get into an argument. But jealousy is what drove the Pharisees to crucify Jesus because they thought they were losing power. Jealousy is what brought the satraps to bring Daniel to the lion's den. Let it not be jealousy that we bring each other down. If you have 100% patience to unbelievers because you want to bring them to the Lord, have 200% of patience to believers. Second point. Worry versus prayer. Daniel 6:10, we see here, but when Daniel learned that the law had been signed, he went home and knelt down as usual in his upstairs room with its windows open toward Jerusalem. He prayed 3 times a day, just as he always done, giving thanks to his God. Now, We studied Philippians 4:6-7. "Do not worry about anything, but in everything, through prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of the Lord that surpasses all understanding will be with you through Christ Jesus." Correct? Daniel knew what was written down. If you pray to anyone else other than King Darius, you will be thrown to the lion's den. What did he do? 3 times. "Bring me to the lion's den. Bring me." Is that what his prayer? No. I think his prayer was, "Lord..." Because he says you're giving thanks to God. Now, let's get into his mind for a minute here. Now, Daniel has been in this country, his adopted country, for many years. I'm pretty sure he's comfortable, too, with this position that he is in. He's living a very comfortable life, folks. He probably has their accent already, just like some of us Filipinos here, right? We forgot to speak Tagalog already because, well, we got this accent. Right? Some of us have developed the accent from America, and then we forget to speak Tagalog. But we get comfortable, right? Like Daniel, he's probably comfortable. He loves his position. He knows what he's doing. So don't you think 30 days? "Well, I'll just stop praying for 30 days, and then I could live a comfortable life again on the 31st day." Because if I don't pray, I'll be thrown into the lion's den. We know how it ended because we've heard this story many times. We know that he'll be rescued from the lion's den. But did he know that? No, he didn't. But what did he know? One thing he knew. God is good. He knew that. And one thing he knew, that he can pray to God and God hears his prayers. He knew that. And that no matter what happens to him, God is still with him. So why would he be giving thanks? Because all of those truths. I know we discussed this last week, but again, it's just good to remind us all the time that the worst thing that could happen to us in this pandemic is that we get sick and then we die. When we die, we go to heaven. I know it's hard to imagine for those of you who just retired or on your way to retirement. And you have plans, you bought the ticket, but it's canceled. You can only redeem it once it's open. I know it's tough. It's tough. I mean, I'm thinking, you know, I'm trying to imagine Gianna getting married too. Come now, Lord Jesus. The normal, the common sense reaction, folks, practical, will be Daniel will not pray for 30 days. No church for 30 days. I'll just come to church when it's safe. When the law says it's okay, when the governor says it's okay, that's when I'll come. Right? That's common sense. But Daniel didn't have any common sense. Right? Well, we can see here. He didn't play it safe, folks. He knew God. That's the biggest difference. You want to see a mature believer from an immature believer? The mature believer depends on God. Most of the time, probably irrational. Like Pastor Charles putting his life on the line right now. Coming to church. CDC says you can't come. I'm glad you're here. But imagine, do you know what we're talking about here? Because some of you folks have not gone to church yet, but have gone to work every day. Some of you folks have watched multiple Netflix episodes, multiple shows, Netflix binged for 30 or 6 months now, but have not finished the Bible. Yeah. Did I get everybody? Or is it? I'm kidding. Why? Why is that? Why are we so quick to apply common sense than depend on God and trust God? Philippians 3:7, before this one, Philippians 3:7-8 reads, "But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ." This is Paul speaking. Paul also lived a very comfortable life before he met Jesus Christ. Paul, not just comfortable, he had a great position in the world. The world was commending him. He was a Pharisee. But when he met Christ, he became a joke. He experienced lashes. He was stoned. He experienced hardship for the Lord. But he said, "All of these things I have counted loss for Christ." American Christians, what is God asking from you that you haven't been giving him? Is that illicit? Is it that illicit relationship? You still can't give it up for God? Is it that one show that's causing you to stumble that you keep watching? What is it? That it's not worth it. God's not worth it. Acts 5:28-29. "We gave you strict orders never again to teach this man's name," he said. "Instead, you have filled all Jerusalem with your teaching about him, and you want to make us responsible for his death." This is a Sadducee speaking to Peter. But Peter and the apostles reply, "We must obey God rather than any human authority." We must obey God than any human authority. Folks, why have we lost the passion to share the gospel? Why have we lost the passion to share to a lost world about Jesus? Why have we lost the desire to live for Christ and to just enjoy everything else, enjoy our lives here, and then go to heaven later? Anybody that tells you sharing the gospel is not from God, they might be a Sadducee. Because the Sadducees ordered the disciples, don't share about Jesus Christ. Don't teach about his life. Don't teach that gospel. And you will stay out of jail. What did the Christians do? What did the first Christians do? We'll go to jail. Throw me in jail. You know, in 1962, the U.S. Supreme Court banned school-sponsored prayer in public schools. That's a decision in 1962, saying that it violated the First Amendment. But students are allowed to meet and pray on school grounds as long as they do so privately and don't try to enforce others to do the same. Let me ask you, has the society progressed from 1962? No. It has digressed. Prayers came out, shootings came in. Right? We're trying to take God out, thinking that everything will be okay. Really? Is the world better? The spirit of the lawless is amongst us. I think it's in 2 Thessalonians. Folks, we are in this society now. This is our society now. Church, don't open. Theaters, wide open. Casinos, open. Churches, 50 below. Who are we to listen to? Are we to listen to the government? Or are we to listen to God? Again, we are to submit to the authorities that are given under us if it doesn't violate what God has told us. This text, we can see here that the enemy and his cronies does not want us to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. Well, it's so clear. Matthew 28:19. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Every opportunity to share the gospel, whether through your life or through your sharing of your life before Christ and your life now, it matters. We don't know when the next opportunity will come for that person that is given your way. Now, what's the best way to pray? Now, three preachers were discussing this. What was the best way to pray? They were doing this right next to a telephone repair man. Now, the first pastor said, it's better to do it on your knees because you get to surrender. The other preacher said, it's better when you're standing up and your hands raised and you're facing the sky because you get to see Jesus. And then the third one says, it's on the floor, lying on the floor, prostrate. That's when you really be praying in the spirit. The repairman could not contain himself no longer, and he said, hey, fellas, he interrupted, the best praying I ever did was hanging upside down from a telephone pole. He was falling. Okay, Matthew 6:6. I thought that was funny. I try. Matthew 6:5-8. Whenever you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, because they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by people. Truly, I tell you, they have their reward. But when you pray, go into your private room, shut your door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you pray, don't babble like the Gentiles, since they imagine they'll be heard for their many words. Don't be like them, because your Father knows the things you need before you ask Him. This is Jesus telling us how to pray. Next week, that's what we'll be discussing, is how to pray. So are you to pray in public? There are, it's called a concert prayer, right? You pray in concert with people, amongst people. That's why we have prayer meetings. We pray together, because if two or three are gathered in my name, I will be in their midst, right? And I will hear their prayers. That's why we have prayer meetings. That's why when we're here, we pray each segment of the service. We're praying. There's time for that. But this one is when you're alone. Now, do you give God a specific time in your day, or do you just give Him the leftovers? Oh, yeah, by the way, I forgot to pray. I have 2 minutes. Lord, You already know what I'm going to ask. I'm in a hurry. I'm running late. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Or, Lord, my prayer today is just like yesterday. Amen. I know it sounds silly, right? But sometimes our attitude about prayer is just like that. It's a laundry list of what we need from God, and hurry, microwave time, press 1 for 1 minute, 2 for 2 minutes. Third point, the watching world. I feel like this is one of this point. As much as we've discussed the prayer, this one we've forgotten. There are people watching you. There are people listening to us. Don't be reckless. Don't be careless of your testimony. For those of you who have not shared the gospel one single bit, and you're living your life not like a Christian, what's your explanation? Because some will tell me, I'm living my life like a Christian, but I can't share. It's just not how I'm built. But I could tell you that their life could bring somebody to Christ, especially during this pandemic. If they know that this person is a Christian and they don't see any worry in this person, he's so calm and collected, and he's the one with the smile, always the one at work giving everybody an assurance that God is in control. I'm sorry you're going through that. Can I pray for you? Not sharing the gospel per se, but living it out. But how about the person who you let everybody know you're a Christian through your Facebook or one way or another? But then you're not living your life as a Christian. Are you that selfish? Let me just be very blunt here. Are you that selfish that you only care about yourself going to heaven and could care less about anybody else watching you? Daniel, it says here, very early the next morning, the king got up and hurried out to the lion's den. When he got there, he called, Daniel, servant of the living God, was your God whom you serve so faithfully able to rescue you from the lions? The king Darius was anxious if Daniel's God was real enough and powerful enough to rescue Daniel from the mouths of the lions. The people that know you're a Christian are anxious, are watching. Is your God that you're serving, that you're claiming, can also give me the peace that I need in this uncertain time? Is your God that you're serving can actually help me in my dire need right now? They're watching you. They're watching you. How are you living your life? Daniel answered, long live the king. My God sent his angel to shut the lions' mouths. It built their appetite so much that when the satraps were thrown in, even before they reached ground, they were like, wah, 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 right? Yum, yum. There was this story about hikers. Some Christian hikers met a bear. Huh? Imagine that, hikers. Raise your hand. No, I'm kidding. They met a bear. Bear was there. And the bear hit the other Christian. The other Christian ran. Let's just name him Noemel. Noemel got hit. Alicia ran, right? Noemel said, "Lord, make this bear a Christian." You know, because Noemel's thinking, if he's a Christian, he's not going to kill me. The prayer hit the bear. The bear said, "Lord, thank you for this food that I'm about to eat." You got to be specific in your prayers. That was our topic last week. The king lost sleep worrying about Daniel. And then he asked the question. And then Daniel showed that nothing was harmed. He was okay. The king and the entire nation knew Daniel's faithfulness to his God. They knew it. And then guess who was put to test? Was it Daniel? The first part was Daniel. When he prayed, it was Daniel that was put to test. But at the end, God was put to test. Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? It was God that was put to test as well. Folks, when you stand for God, God is the one that is put to test. When you are losing friends because you are now a Christian, God is put to test. Last Friday, a California court rejected Friday efforts by Los Angeles County to require a popular megachurch to comply with pandemic orders, allowing the church to hold indoor services with singing and without attendance limits, pending a resolution of the case. Supreme Court Judge James Chalfant denied the county's request for a temporary restraining order against Grace Community Church after the church began holding services July 26 in defiance of state and county rules aimed at combating the novel coronavirus, according to a press release from the Thomas More Society. Attorney Jenna Ellis called it a historic win. The Thomas More Society, which represented the church, said the judge, quote unquote, "It is the county's burden to show why it should be permitted to infringe on the constitutionally protected rights of churches to freely exercise religion, but also expressing safety concerns." Grace Community Church Pastor John MacArthur said in a statement, "We are happy for a few weeks to comply and respect what the judge has asked us because he is allowing us to meet. This vindicates our desire to stay open and serve our people," unquote, said MacArthur. "This also gives us an opportunity to show that we are not trying to be rebellious or unreasonable, but that we will stand firm to protect our church against unreasonable and unconstitutional restrictions." See? When, yes, the Lord reserves a round of applause for that, I think, because the Grace Community Church stood their ground to worship God, to praise God through singing and through their physical attendance. They fought the governor of California. They fought the mayor. They fought the county. And guess who won? God won. I know we know about the church in Dayton losing, but hey, this is 1-1 now. Daniel 6:25-27. You will see here, "I decree that everyone throughout my kingdom should tremble with fear before the God of Daniel." This is King Darius sending this letter to everybody, testifying for the God of Daniel. Because he saw it with his own eyes. He felt it. Hebrews 12, 1-3, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. This is our God. The God of Daniel is our God. Amen? Now remember, we will never stand up for God if we don't get down on our knees. Praying to God gives, and then asking for strength, asking for boldness, asking for help, asking for wisdom on our knees, praying, knowing that He hears our prayers, knowing that He has the power to supply what we need, whether it's boldness, whether it's strength, knowing that God hears our prayers should make all of us become prayerful. Not just the quick prayers, although those are good. Yes, every time, every moment you should be praying. But have you set aside in your day, during your day, to pray to God and say, Lord, I remember this guy that he said, Lord, today I have not sinned. I have not gossiped. I have not gone mad at anybody. But now, Lord, before I get up from bed, as my day starts, help me. Right, the only time that we haven't sinned usually is when we're still in bed. But the time that we get up, right? Sin here, sin there, sin here, failure there. A few questions for us. How is your prayer life? How much time do you spend with God? How is your testimony? Are you living your life around your family and friends that have not accepted Jesus as their Lord, glorifying to Him? Is living for God your number one priority, or is it just a Sunday thing? Knowing God in trying times always brings forth peace and joy despite the dangers or uncertainty of our situation. Looking at Daniel's life, his knowledge of God made him pray to God daily, three times a day, even with the risk of losing his life. Because for Daniel, serving God, praying to God, was his number one priority. This shows us believers of the same God, this is the living God, that if we truly believe in Him, that all things happen because God allowed it, and all our life, everything from our life is from Him, this tells us that we need to always be grateful to God. This tells us that we need to be asking God for everything and anything, and it tells us that despite the challenges that we are facing, God is still good. But the only way that we can really have this resolve for God to strengthen our weaknesses, for God to give us boldness, for God to make us faithful, is we need to be connected with Him. And the only way, the one true way for us to be connected is when we pray to Him. When we pray to Him. Praying keeps us grounded. Praying pleases God. And He always gives grace to the humble. Praying humbles us. It tells us that apart from Him, we can do nothing. That everything is from Him. So Lord, please, give me the wisdom to give all of this that You've given me for You. We sang it earlier. This is What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear, what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Are you weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Do your friends despise, forsake you? Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield you. You will find solace there. Let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you for your message tonight. We ask for forgiveness, Father, for the many hours that we have spent on any other things other than praying to you and spending time with you. Forgive us, Lord, for the times that we have failed in our testimony. When we chose to please ourselves and please and live for you. Father, empower us by your Holy Spirit that indwells in all of us to crave and to desire to pray to you, to get down on our knees and rest on you. Give us all the wisdom to apply what we've learned tonight and heard. And Father, be with us and guide us. In your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and all the Lord's people said, amen, amen. Amen. Let's all stand for the closing hymn.